So, Fabrienne, you have been doing some documentary research lately. I hope I can keep up. Actually, we had planned on doing further videos explaining the general workings of Fabry disease. Then, we heard about a patient doing self-treatment with galactose and halted production of those videos. Since the last video went live, a number of Fabry patients have contacted Fabrienne. It seems like there is not just one patient doing self-treatment using galactose. Now, with 2 weeks of additional research and a number of patients' stories, we're doing a second video on the subject. In brief, we would still prefer that physicians treat Fabry patients with Fabry-specific medication, but that's not always the case. Patients with amenable mutations can, after consultation with a primary care physician or general practitioner, try galactose to alleviate their symptoms. Because of the remaining uncertainties, progress monitoring by a physician seems prudent. This does not constitute medical advice. Though the following information was collected with utmost care, it is for educational purposes only and does not substitute a doctor's consultation. History of galactose research. In 1995, galactose was demonstrated to stabilize various missense mutants of alpha-galactosidase A. In cell culture experiments, 11 missense variants were investigated, and enzymatic activity was found to increase significantly in 4 out of 8 classical mutations and in all 3 atypical mutations. Thermal stability and pH stability were also found to improve. In 2001, a case study was published of a 55-year-old man who was treated with galactose infusions. At the beginning of the experiment, he had severe myocardial disease and was a candidate for cardiac transplantation. For the first 3 days, he was given infusions of 1 gram of galactose per kilogram of body weight daily. After those first 3 days, infusions with the same amount of galactose were administered every other day. After 3 months of therapy, the left ventricular ejection fraction, the proportion of blood in the left heart chamber that is ejected each time the heart contracts, increased from 33%, which is considered reduced, to 55%, which is considered normal. Left ventricular hypertrophy, an abnormal thickening of the heart muscle that is typical for the cardiac phenotype of Fabry disease, was reduced. Cardiac transplantation was no longer deemed necessary, and the patient could return to full-time work. The paper was published after 2 years of treatment, and during this time period, the galactose infusions were considered well tolerated. Heart function further improved slightly during these 2 years. After that, no further papers regarding treatment of Fabry disease using galactose were published. The usual reason that is given for abandoning development of galactose therapy is dosage. The 1 gram per kilogram of body weight that was used during the galactose infusion experiment was considered impractical. There are no published data regarding treatment of Fabry patients using lower dosages of galactose. Therefore, the minimum effective dose is unknown. Another possible reason for the abandonment of the development of galactose therapy might be possible overall better results with migalastat. The relative increase in enzyme activity was comparable, though much higher concentrations of galactose were used. Again, there are no published data applying lower concentrations of galactose. This means that we have no reliable information explaining the abandonment of galactose therapy in favor of the development of a prohibitively expensive substance. Information about galactose therapy. As there is no information regarding the dosage, timing and administration of galactose for the treatment of Fabry disease, Fabrienne gathered information from the patients who contacted her. The data Fabrienne will now present might be the best information currently available on this subject. Research on the treatment of certain types of Alzheimer's disease with galactose have demonstrated that oral administration leads to the appearance of galactose in the blood. Galactose can not only be absorbed in the small intestine, but also in the oral cavity. That means that dissolving galactose in saliva and keeping it in the mouth for a few minutes leads to quick absorption of galactose into the bloodstream. Galactose competes with glucose for the same transporters. That is why consumption of other sugars immediately before or after taking galactose lessens its uptake. Patient experience suggests that a time span of at least half an hour before and after taking galactose, or even up to an hour, greatly enhances its beneficial effect. Because of the relative importance of the SGLT1 transporters for the oral absorption of galactose, adding a pinch of salt to the galactose may further enhance its uptake. Early experiments with galactose used very high concentrations. We have found no published data using lower concentrations of galactose. Several brands that offer galactose as food supplements on the German market suggest the use of single doses of 4 grams. Most patients we know use these 4-gram doses. One patient reported that the smaller doses were less effective. The patients Fabrian knows take up to 4 single doses a day. Galactose appears to be well tolerated. The single case study that was published supports this notion, as it suggests that galactose should be considered for treatment without reservations regarding possible adverse effects of long-term treatment with high dosages of galactose. Still, some things are to be considered. Galactosemia is a contraindication for galactose treatment. High doses of galactose, for example more than a gram per kilogram of body weight, are used to induce aging-related effects in scientific research. In these experiments, galactose is usually administered per injection. Galactose is only expected to work with amenable mutations. We know of one scientific publication reporting the amenability of 8 missense mutations. Fabrian knows patients with a D313Y and A143T mutations who appear to respond well. Amenability for existing chaperone therapy might offer an indication for galactose amenability. The patients we know report a marked reduction of pain under self-treatment with galactose. One patient reported an increased mobility of certain joints associated with a temporary increase in joint pain. The information Fabrian managed to gather from patients is still limited. However, the preliminary results are positive. She heard one patient laugh for the first time in months. Sugar dissolved in liquid seems to be a real solution. Galactose is the original Fabry therapy. ERT for Fabry disease was developed after the example of Gaucher treatment, and chaperone therapy was developed after the model of galactose therapy. Now, you might wonder, is the production of large amounts of galactose viable? Galactose is a byproduct of the production of protein shakes from whey, which itself is a waste product of the dairy industry. Whey lactose is even considered for production of ethanol, suggesting we have no lack in source material. Fabrian, however, won't use galactose. Her dream is that no patient should be excluded from a therapy that brings greater benefit than risk. Fabry patients should receive Fabry treatments from Fabry experts, and that's what she's fighting for. So, we hope this video explains the potential risks and benefits of Fabry treatment using galactose. Fabrian did some hard work researching and writing this one, and she will continue to collect patient information. If we learn something new, you will find a video here. And as always, feel free to write and have a wonderful day.